I'll be talking about the WHO 2016 classification of gliomas in this lecture. So there has been an increased trend towards love for the molecular markers as per the new classification in 2016, which has incorporated the molecular markers. The reason for that is this graph that you can see. In the 20 years of brain tumor research, the glioblastoma patient survival from 1995 to 2015, the 5-year survival has improved from 3% to just 4.7%. So despite all the research till now, the survival is really poor. The median overall survival for patients with glioblastoma is 15 months to 30 months, depending on whether it's primary glioblastoma or secondary glioblastoma. The 4 FDA-approved treatments for brain tumor surgery resection are maximal surgical resection, the radiation therapy, temozolomide, and tumor treatment fields, which was recently approved. So this is the new classification, which is updated from the 4th edition, and this was done according to the meeting in Haarlem, the Netherlands, and it included 28 neuropathologists from 10 countries. There was input from neuro-oncologists, medical oncologists, neurosurgeons, neuroradiologists, and radiation oncologists. So the major question that was addressed was, how can non-histological criteria be used to enhance typing and grading of human brain tumors? So initially, according to the histological classification, the type 1 was a special circumscribed tumors, type 2 was cytological atypia alone, type 3 had anaplasia and mitotic activity, and type 4 had endothelial proliferation and necrosis. In the 2007, which I talked about, the glioma was classified as astrocytoma, oligodendroglioma, mixed oligoastrocytoma, and ependymomas. Astrocytomas were further classified as diffused or localized. In the 2016 classification of gliomas, the gliomas are divided into diffuse or localized. The diffuse glioma can be oligoastrocytoma, oligodendroglioma, or astrocytoma. And the term mixed oligoastrocytoma is discouraged in the current classification. So gliomas can be localized, which are potentially curable by a complete surgical resection, and diffuse, which are not curable by surgical resection. So coming to the genetics, if we look at the glioma precursor cell, if the glioma acquires the IDH1 mutation, which is the isocitrate dehydrogenase 1 mutation, then it can either lead to formation of astrocytoma or oligodendroglioma. If along with the IDH1 mutation there is 1p19q codeletion, then it is oligodendroglioma. It has both prognostic and diagnostic significance. And 1p19q is a prerequisite for the diagnosis of oligodendroglioma. If the patient doesn't have 1p19q codeletion but has an ATRX loss, it is a grade 2 astrocytoma, and if it further de-differentiates, it can lead to formation of a secondary glioblastoma. If the patient is IDH wild type and acquires other mutations such as P10 mutations and IGFR amplifications or IGFR mutations, then it leads to formation of primary glioblastoma, which has the worst prognosis. As I said earlier, if it's IDH mutant with 1p19q non-deletion and ATRX loss, it is diffuse astrocytoma. If 1p19q codeletion is present, it is oligodendroglioma. And if it is IDH wild type, it is diffuse astrocytoma IDH wild type WHO grade 2. If the testing is not performed or if it's not available, then it is not specified. Coming to this flowchart, as we can see, the histology can be astrocytoma, oligoastrocytoma, oligodendroglioma. Oligoastrocytoma term should be avoided as per the new classification, although it is carried forward. Or it can be glioblastoma. Now, glioblastoma can be IDH mutant or IDH wild type and classified accordingly. Now, all these three astrocytomas, oligoastrocytoma and oligodendroglioma, can be IDH mutant or IDH wild type. If there is ATRX loss, it is diffuse astrocytoma. If 1p19q codeletion is present, it is oligodendroglioma. Now coming to oligodendrogliomas, diagnosis of oligodendroglioma and anaplastic oligodendroglioma requires demonstration of IDH mutation as well as 1p19q codeletion. It is now essentially defined by a particular genetic phenotype. Diffuse astrocytoma has three categories: IDH mutant, IDH wild type, and not otherwise specified. WHO grading remains the same, even though IDH mutant cases have a more favorable prognosis. So IDH mutation is very important for prognosis. Oligoastrocytoma, as I said, it is discouraged and should only be used in very rare circumstances, and if absence of diagnostic molecular testing is there, then NOS category should be used. Coming to glioblastomas, there are three categories of glioblastoma: IDH wild type, which is the most common one, which leads to primary GBM and has the worst prognosis; IDH mutant type, which is less common and it corresponds to secondary GBM and has a better prognosis; and glioblastoma, in which the typing could not be done, is NOS type. So this is another important slide comparing the IDH wild type and the IDH mutant glioblastoma. As I said, IDH wild type is primary glioblastoma, in which the precursor lesion is not identifiable, and it is the most common type of glioblastoma seen in older age group. The mean survival is only 9.9 months, and despite all the therapies that have been mentioned before, the overall median survival is just 15 months. Coming to the IDH mutant glioblastoma, it is usually a secondary glioblastoma in which the precursor lesion is a diffuse or anaplastic astrocytoma. It forms 10% of glioblastoma with a relatively younger age group, and the median age median survival is 31 months. Now, a new variant of glioblastoma is epithelioid glioblastoma. It joins giant cell glioblastoma and gliosarcoma. It has a predilection for young adults and children. It has BRAF V600E mutation, lacks the typical IDH wild-type GBM molecular features, and there may be an associated low-grade precursor query PXA. Another variant is GBM with primitive neuronal component. It is a previously GBM with peanut-like component, diffuse glioma any grade with well-demarcated nodules of primitive cells with neuronal differentiation. It shows MYC and MYC-N amplification, and it has increased prediction for CSF dissemination. The variants which have been deleted in the new classification are the protoplasmic astrocytoma and the fibrillary astrocytoma and gliomatosis cerebri. Now this is a very important variant that has been added. So the diffuse midline glioma, which behave as grade 4 tumor and have a very very poor prognosis, are the H3K27M mutant gliomas. They were earlier classified under DIPGs, but now it's diffuse midline glioma H3K27M mutation with a worse prognosis. Now coming to ependymomas, the ependymomas can be supratentorial or posterior fossa. The supratentorial are more common in children, and the 5-year progression-free survival is around 47%, and the most important molecular marker associated with them is the RALA translocation. So RALA positive ependymomas are usually supratentorial, which are more common in children, and the 5-year progression free survival is 47%. Now coming to the posterior fossa tumors, they are further classified into type A and type B. Type A are usually present in younger children with a median age of 2.5 years and 70% are male. Type B has a median age of 20 years and 50% are male. So they have the worst prognosis than type B. They extend laterally into the cerebellopontine angle. and they have various molecular profile and genetics like CpG island methylator phenotype positive. Now coming to type B, it has a better prognosis than type A, and the location is usually midline cerebellum or spinal cord. Even though they have extensive genomic instability, their prognosis is better than type A. So Rayla fusion positive, as I talked about, is seen in supratentorial. They are more common in children and it has a poor prognosis. Now coming to various other markers and mutations such as BRAF. So BRAF fusions are seen in pilocytic astrocytomas, and BRAF mutations are seen in tumors such as gangliogliomas and PXAs. Ganglioglioma and PXA, and fusions are seen in pilocytic astrocytoma. So they affect the tyrosine kinase pathway, and various drugs are being developed for the same to act on the BRAF mutation, and namely they are sorafenib and vemurafenib. So these are the five FDA approved agents for the brain tumor patients since 1982. So in 1982, initially the drugs that were approved were the carmustin and lomustin. In 1999, temozolomide was approved, and it is the mainstay of chemotherapy in cases of glioma nowadays. In 2009, bevacizumab, which is a VEGF antagonist, was approved. And recently in 2018, everolimus was approved. So hence there has been this change or this love towards the molecular markers, because the molecular markers are important in diagnosis and classification, in prognostication, in predicting the response to therapy. And there have been multiple phase 0 trials going on, and they are including a few patients to find out the new and improved drugs which can improve the grave prognosis of glioblastoma. Thank you.